Mike DeBurgess along with Anthony Carlo for episode number 6 of the Sports Sit-Down. And Anthony, week 6 of the NFL. Believe it or not, the Giants may have salvaged the season. They're 3-3 after a come-from-behind win over the Baltimore Ravens.
Hey, it's about time. The New York Giants get a win. As positive as I want to be, it didn't come in pretty fashion, in my opinion. I mean, they barely squeak out a win over the Baltimore Ravens, who really have a depleted defense. And the fact that this Giants offense, which was so highly touted in the beginning of the year, was only able to barely squeak out a win over the Ravens, coming back in the fourth quarter because of Odell Beckham Jr., it's a little worrisome to me. But why don't we talk about Odell Beckham Jr.?
Well, let's talk about Odell Beckham Jr. First off, it was an ugly first half. The Giants looked like they weren't ready to play. Right. And in the second half, someone finally tapped Odell on the shoulder and said, "Odell, we're playing football. Wake up." He exploded, had over 220 yards, yeah. Two long touchdowns. Of course, the last one, 66 yards with under a minute to play, made some great moves. Eli audibled at the line, and the Giants win the game 27-23. But, Odell, you got to keep your head in the game. He took off his helmet. That led to a penalty that could have cost the Giants. There was no guarantee, even after the touchdown, that the Giants got to win this game, Anthony.
Well, once Jimmy Smith was hurt, it turned out that Odell Beckham Jr. remembered how to play football again. Obviously, whoever tried to defend him after that couldn't, and Odell Beckham Jr. went crazy. Here's my problem, Mike. When I look at Odell Beckham Jr., I love the passion. You go for a career high of 222 yards, I don't blame you for being excited and happy. Here's my only issue. You've got to act like you've been there before. And sometimes when I'm watching Odell Beckham Jr., when he's kneeling on the ground and proposing to a backup field goal net, he's ripping the helmet off, he's going crazy, the guy looks like it's the first time he's ever had a big game.
Oh, I agree, Anthony, and he's got to really keep control of himself because this Giants team has zero room for error. You know what this team reminds me of a little bit? And I thought Victor Cruz would be a bigger factor coming into this year. This might be the last year that Victor Cruz is a Giant because he's just not the same Victor Cruz. But here's what the Giants are. They have zero impact linebacker. They don't have a running game. The defensive line is not what they thought it would be despite all the investment made on them. And when I look at this Giant team, it reminds me a lot of the Miami Dolphins in the 80s. It was Dan Marino, Mark Clayton, Mark Duper.
And nothing else.
It's Eli Manning and Odell Beckham.
Yeah.
This team will go as far as these players will take it. However, right, they are only going to beat the mediocre teams. They are not going to beat the elite teams in the NFL. And you know what? The Dallas Cowboys now are an elite team in the NFL, and no one expected that.
With Tony Romo coming back. And it'll be interesting enough to see if Jerry Jones decides to start him.
Yeah. I don't think there's any way that Jerry Jones and the Cowboys, well, he's not going to
make that decision.
He's not going to make that decision. There's no way that the Cowboys can do that with Prescott playing the way he's playing. There's no way. And right, there will be a revolt on the team. They got to stick with the kid. And what a performance they're getting from the young running back and their quarterback. I mean, really amazing story in Dallas. Moving along, when you thought it couldn't get any worse, the New York Jets just made it worse. Because right now they got hammered and embarrassed. A shambles on Monday night. They lose to the Cardinals 28-3. Things can't get much worse in Jetland.
No, and it's funny that you transitioned from the Cowboys to the Jets. With Tony Romo coming back, they're going to stick with the kid, possibly Dak Prescott. Well, the Jets have decided to stick with their kid, right, by benching Ryan Fitzpatrick and going back to Geno Smith. This reminds me of a bad comedy. It really does. Like a bad movie that it doesn't end. It's like deja vu again. Maybe Geno Smith needed 14 months off and a punch in the jaw to wake up and come back like gangbusters. I don't know, but all I know is if this goes downhill again, I don't think the Jets have ever been in a worse position than this in franchise history.
Yes, they have. And I was there. I was around in 1996 when the Jets went 1-15.
Oh, by the way,
1-15, and followed that up with a 3-13? No, I'm sorry. The year before that, they were 3-13, 95. 1-15 in 1996, and that brought in the Bill Parcells era. There have been low points. Also, 1989, a real low point in franchise history under Joe Walton before he was fired, before they brought Bruce Costlin in. I don't know what's gone wrong with this team because I thought Todd Bowles was going to be the right guy, a Parcells disciple, a defensive guy, soft-spoken, well-respected. I thought the players would relate to him, an African-American coach, the anti-Rex Ryan. And somewhere along the line, Bowles has lost this team.
He has. And you know what? I appreciate his decision to decide to sit Ryan Fitzpatrick, okay? Because at this point, somebody's got to shake this team up. And if I was Todd Bowles, I would start sitting more than just Ryan Fitzpatrick. I would start putting in different players because this team is not cutting it. Now, the only downside to that is because he's sitting Ryan Fitzpatrick, that only means that Geno Smith is coming back. And if you're a Jets fan right now and you've seen what Geno Smith has done in the past, you can't feel completely confident in this team. Well, Ryan Fitzpatrick looked absolutely horrible.
Let's look at Geno. 11 and 18 as a starter, 27 touchdowns, 36 interceptions. This is his last chance in the NFL.
We've said that before. You know we have.
So here's his opportunity. The Jets are 1-5. And it goes to show you in the NFL, when you miss spring practice, okay, when you miss the summer sessions, when you miss exhibition games, it affects you. It affects you in football from a training standpoint. There's a such thing as being in football shape and being in shape. Fitzpatrick was not in football shape, and his timing was off despite the so-called relationship he had with Marshall and everything. This has been a total disaster, and I think things are going to get worse for Jet fans. You don't want to hear it, but it is. They're old on the offensive line. They got nothing at linebacker. David Harris, how much longer is he going to be around? Darrell Revis, how much longer is he going to be around? Wholesale changes in the secondary. Brandon Marshall, not a young guy, wrong side of 30. Major changes in Jetland. It's going to take 2 to 3 years to rebuild again for the Jets. Sure. Rebuild. I can't believe I'm saying it. This team has to rebuild every 3 damn years. I'm sick of it.
Okay, take it easy. Well, I don't blame you. I mean, failing on your first 8 third down attempts and having a total of 230 yards, an offensive total of 230 yards by the time the game is over. Listen, this is why I'm posing this whole little proposition to you. I think this team, the franchise, the way it is, it's heading back to those dark ages that you mentioned before. I don't know if it's the worst it's ever been in the franchise. Obviously, it's not. You mentioned a couple of other times it's been pretty bad, but this is pretty bad. I mean, it doesn't get a whole lot worse than this.
Anthony, nothing's worse than what 1996 was. I mean,
it's going back that way.
That was the year of Kashawn, give me the damn ball. Moving along to another story that touched the hearts of many New Yorkers and football fans, Dennis Byrd passed away, the former defensive lineman for the Jets. In 1992, Byrd was paralyzed when he collided with teammate Scott Mercero against the Kansas City Chiefs. I was at that game, and I remember the eerie silence that really covered the stadium. Now, Dennis Byrd, look at these numbers. He had 28 sacks in his first 57 games. 40 of them were starts. Right. He wound up he had 20 sacks in his first 32 games, okay? That is an incredible, incredible number when you look at today's game. His career was cut short when he became paralyzed. Yeah. But amazingly, a year later, he was able to actually walk onto the field at Giants Stadium.
Right.
And what an incredible story through the years, battling the injury to his neck, being able to walk again. Doctors never thought that he'd be able to walk again. And what an incredible, incredible story. And for have his life to be cut short, a car accident 50 years old.
Horrible.
You know, just a horrible situation. But we should forget who Dennis Byrd was as a person. He had courage, bravery. When you look at role models, you look at some of the stuff that goes on in pro sports, Dennis Byrd is a hero, and we didn't hear enough about him. I'm not sure if you were familiar with who he was.
I was familiar.
But you hear about all the loudmouths in the NFL, and you watch these NFL shows with Michael Irvin and Deion Sanders. Right. You know, Dennis Byrd was never mentioned. The NFL should not forget about these guys. And, again, what an incredible player, 28 sacks in 57 NFL games, 20 sacks in his first 32, numbers that would make him making $15, $17 million a year if he was playing today.
Only Mark Gastineau and John Abraham were the only other two players who were able to put up similar numbers. I liked how you mentioned he was such an inspiration off the field because as amazing as he was on the field in those 3.5 short years, I believe he played halfway through his fourth season before he was injured, to come back from paralysis and beat the odds when doctors were giving him such a grim diagnosis that he may never walk again, to come back and walk again, it's an unbelievable story. And then to die in a car accident at age 50, it just kind of it's a punch to the gut. Because you know how much adversity, you know, and how much this guy went through and overcame, the last Jet to ever wear number 90.
Yeah.
Deservingly so.
And 1992 was the year the Jets were supposed to. They were 5-0 in the preseason. Browning Nagel, the young quarterback. Right. And they wound up going 4-12 that year. So it was a dark, dark year. You're talking about low points for the organization. Nothing gets lower than that. Right. Anyway, that wraps things up for the Sports Sit Down. I'm Mike Demergis. He's Anthony Carlo.